Better turn that off and where the heck is my camera? See. No, that doesn't work. Ba ba da da ba da. Video capture device. That's weird. Ah, there we go. Get these cords up here straightened out. Now it's working. I think that looks about good. Okay, so camera's set. Let's go. I haven't played this game yet, even though I've got you can see that I've got the deluxe content in the background. First off, get that out of the way. Thank you. It's worth a shot. Left click or enter, space to against text only. This is a screenshot. Middle click. Discovered a strange device in the middle of nowhere during one of our expeditions. Portal. I heard about similar technology before, though that had been more on an experimental level. From what I knew, other portals had been crafted in the past and were under consideration for mass application. For this one in particular, though, we did not know who had built it, nor when, or why we found it in the wilderness where we did. What was more exciting to us was the fact that it was functional. After our first test, we found there was someone else on the other side who was in possession of a similar portal. And our attempts at communication through letters were successful, but in the end, the machine's extraordinary demand for power meant we could need to act quickly as we wouldn't be able to keep the portal open much longer. When we made this note to the other side, we received a very unexpected reply. A letter of invitation. After some deliberation, it was decided to accept their hospitality and send a person to the other side. There was an individual who took the job almost immediately. I don't know if you guys can see me that well, but this is straining my eyes. Izquierdo. I knew him, or rather, had known him. We attended the same school, and even had a few classes together. We never really were close friends, but we talked to each other occasionally and hung around the same crowd sometimes. However, we still went our separate ways in the end. To think about the whole thing, but he had to have known that he had to have known what he was doing. He was certainly brave. Either that, or just very, very foolish. While I wasn't sure which, his courage was applauded by others. After all, he couldn't possibly have known who or what would await him at the other side, end of the portal. And if he did meet someone there, who knew what kinds of intentions they might have? Not that any speculation on our part would have made a difference. The day finally came. Through he went, with applause echoing across the area, equipped only with the clothes he wore, his multi-tool, a gun, and a device on his wrist that acted as a PDA. Then we waited. The crowd that was applauding him slowly dispersed when the enthusiasm died down, as there was nothing for us to do but wait and speculate. Approximately 8 hours later, we received our first message from him. While we had assumed the portal led to another in a different country, or maybe on a different continent, the reality turned out to be much more boring. The situation he described to us was so outlandish that we initially took it as a joke. A very bad joke, maybe. Worst timing and no punchline at all. It soon became clear to us, though, that we may have just made one of the most important discoveries since the dawn of mankind. Finding the portal had been remarkable in itself, but this took it to a completely different level. From what he described about the place, or more accurately, its inhabitants, we surmised it could not be part of Earth at all. We called them dragons, because according to Reza, that's what they were, or at least what they resembled most. Even though we found it hard to believe, it had been these dragons who sent us all the letters, and what Reza found on the other side of the portal was a whole civilization of them. They could talk, write books, had building and electricity. In many ways, their society was actually very similar to our own. So, who were they? And where was this place? Could they be aliens? Our speculation led us to conclude otherwise. After all, we knew about the existence of thousands of planets, millions of light years away that may have been theoretically habitable. Yet even then, we had never found conclusive proof to actual alien life. Some people brought up quantum mechanics and parallel universes, but in the end of all, this was just a conjecture and an ultimately fruitless endeavor, since we neither had the means nor the resources to explore these possibilities in greater detail. I think there's just one more thing worth mentioning before I move on. Previous isolation had been mutual. They hadn't known about any other intelligent life form beyond their own. Their portal had only recently been discovered and with technology previously unknown to them. Just as we had messed about dragons, they had messed about us. That was what we knew about them so far. And as interesting as learning those things and debating their cultural significance was, we didn't really know what we should make of it at all. Reza apparently was sure of what he was doing, though, as he eventually let us know that he had agreed on a trade. We were going to give them a few of our PDA devices, which contained vast amounts of knowledge, dwarfing even that of encyclopedias. In return, they would supply us with generators. Overall, they didn't seem technologically advanced as we had been, but they did surpass us in that one aspect. Their means of generating energy seemed sustainable. Not only that, but it evidently also quite efficient. We certainly would be able to put technology like that to good use. And trading mere past knowledge of the human race for something more tangible was a good call on his part. That was where I came in. My prior experience in both biology and sociology made me a good fit to deliver our PDA devices for the trade. And while in the dragon's world, waiting for the prototypes of our generators to be manufactured by them, I would act as an ambassador on humanity's behalf. What a way to make a first impression on display of mutual goodwill. Everyone benefits and everyone goes home happy. All is well. At least, that was the plan. Despite the images that living, talking dragons might conjure up in some people's minds, I didn't even think of bringing a weapon myself, considering that they were reportedly friendly and peaceful enough. There was no need for me to fear potential ill intentions like Reza did when he had stepped into unknown territory, acting as humanity's ambassador. I had to do my best to uphold a high standard in fostering this diplomatic relationship. When the time came for me to step through the portal, all my mental preparedness vanished. My anxiousness was fueled by all the questions lurking in my head, just as the machine started to do its work.
Would it hurt?
Who would I meet on the other side? What if they really weren't so friendly and just made Reza write those letters, with the presence of appearing friendly, only to lure us into the den of man-eating monsters and certain doom, with us ending up as nothing more than a tasty afternoon snack? Maybe I should have brought a weapon after all. Suddenly, I felt a shiver coursing through my whole body and beyond when I disintegrated, as if every cell, every atom of my body was torn from me and pulled into a different direction. I saw darkness and light, painting patterns in the stars as I traveled, and images rapidly flashed before me of things unseen and unspoken. Both horrifying and beautiful. It was an experience unlike any other, yet over in just a split second. Then it was dark. I could only see a patch of light color contrasting its dark surroundings as my vision started to clear. The edges got sharper as the patch of light slowly took shape, giving me the distinguished outline of a reptilian head and an array of horns spouting from it. It was a dragon! And as I could now see, a dragon who not only had a pair of round glasses, but also wore a burgundy tie around its neck. In the name of our people, I bid you welcome. If I may introduce myself, I am Remy, your guide and ambassador, a representative of our council. The dragon spoke! It was one thing to have heard and read about this, but something else entirely to have one standing in front of me, in flesh and blood, and tongue. It was good that all my mental preparedness this had disappeared when I was teleported, because nothing could have prepared me for this. Sorry, I imagine you might still feel the effects of the teleportation. Drowsiness or weakness is not usual, as is fainting or spontaneous emptying of your bowels, flat, header, or stomach. How do you feel? Rendered speechless, I had totally forgotten that he was shouldering the burden of representing my people to them as well. So much for being professional, but at least he gave me a good excuse for my blunder. I think I'm all right. Well, I'm glad to hear that. Maybe we should go before it gets too dark. Come with me, please. So I followed the dragon, not straying too far from him, as the sun had already departed for the day and the remaining light diminished by the minute. It is getting hard to see where I'm going. Sorry about that, but we had a good reason to schedule your arrival like this. We did not want you to be ambushed by a crowd, so we had to keep your exact time and date of arrival secret. Thanks. I suppose an event like this would make me a celebrity of sorts. It would be the same if one of you came to us. That's quite an understatement. Some people are rather superstitious. They might even regard you or any of your kind as divine, I suppose. Really? How so? We do have certain myths that involve humans and as such. Oh, I suppose the history lesson will have to wait for another time. Here we are. Here we are. By this point, it had gotten so dark that I could barely make out the building before us. I briefly wondered whether they might have streetlights elsewhere, or if they did not require any due to possible enhanced eyesight or night vision. I could vaguely see the dragon, his light color still visible within the blackness that engulfed the area. Rear up and manipulate the door handle with one of his forepaws. Hinges creaking, the door opened, and with a flick of a switch, the apartment was flooded with light, blinding me after all this time we had spent without it. This is where you will live for the time being. It is fully stocked, but in case you need anything else, I left you a note with a few phone numbers. It is getting rather late, so I will have to take my leave now. In any case, someone will come and meet you tomorrow morning. Thank you, Remy. Good night. Until we meet again. With a nod, Remy left the apartment, mindful enough to close the door behind himself. Surveying the room, I considered the events that had just transpired as my gaze met the window. I could see movements outside, and as I drew nearer, startled, I could hear footsteps in the grass, moving away quickly. Assuming it must have been the dragon I just met, I thought nothing of it as I went to bed and slowly succumbed to the sweet allure of sleep overdue. I spent a few moments thinking about my role, my mission, and what it meant to be here now. So many possibilities and prospects raced through my mind. Truth be told, the thought of being able to meet an entirely new species and civilization excited me. As I was going to be one of the first to truly experience their society with its own little quirks, differences, and similarities, I couldn't help but feel like some sort of modern Vasco da Gama or Marco Polo. Maybe I should even write a book about the whole experience after it's all over. I was sure it would become a hit, all things considered. At any rate, this was going to be fun. At any rate, this was going to be fun. Something not in the demo. I've played the demo. I awoke from uneasy dreams looking at an unfamiliar ceiling. Just for a moment, I wondered where I was before the events of last night all came back to me. After a good stretch, I looked around the room, illuminated by the sunlight coming in from the window. Outside, in the distance, the poor light had emerged from proudly stood on the peak of a small hill. Getting ready, I noticed something was lying on the table. It was the note Remy left for me in case I needed anything, along with his own home phone and work number. there were also some numbers for delivery of food and other necessities, as well as emergency and even janitorial services. He had certainly thought of everything, even though I now had to wonder what a dragon and flower would look like. My musings were interrupted when the doorbell rang. When I opened the door, I was met by another dragon. Bumps and scales on his rough skin. Nice to meet you too, Sebastian. So, where are you taking me? Straight to business, eh? We're going to visit the plant where they're making your generators. They have some news for you, or so I've heard. Reza will be there too. Sounds great. Just follow me. I was under the impression we were purposely avoiding the busier parts of town, instead straying towards the edges and small alleys as not to garner too much attention. Yep. Even then, we got the occasional stare. I'm sure the same would happen if a dragon was in the human world. After just a couple of minutes, we arrived at our destination, where we were met by Reza, as well as yet another dragon, a vicious-looking beast that didn't stay too close to him. I know who it is. Hello! Growled the skin, darker dragons, trembling lips as he bears to the raven. us all go inside already, shall we? After you. The crisis was quickly averted as we entered the building, which was characterized by its many floors, high ceilings, and long, narrow hallways as Sebastian led us to our destination. There you are. I was waiting for you. Going to meet the guys up from production. What are you doing here? They're only coming in later today, so you'll have to make do with me. I see. Well, Miss Anna kind of manages this building, although she's more involved with the research wing rather than production and engineering. Took my hand into hers before she pressed the device into the back of my hand. I winced it as pain jolted through my hand. Something sharp drove itself into my skin, and shortly afterwards, a drop of blood was sucked into the tube attached to a small needle. Thanks. You're welcome. Something that doesn't happen in the demo. Looks like your PDA is good, by the way. So we're just about done here. We're both in biology. It could be interesting if you wanted to be some other time as well. Here's my number. Alright. See you soon. Well, that was interesting. Well, I can say that again. Thank you. not taking a bite out of either of us. Luckily for us, the cafe was mostly empty when we arrived, as it was still pretty early in the day. Razor was quick to lead me to the table, which prompted us to drag him to get one of their own at the other side of the restaurant. You're kind of in a hurry, Razor. Finally. I can't stand that guy being on my tail all the damn time. Approached by an individual who appeared to be the waitress of the cafe. She was an interesting looking dragon, who, unlike the other dragons I had seen so far, was much more akin to a lizard, possessing two rather large wings as her forelegs, which resembled those of an oversized bat. I'll take today's special. Yeah, me too. Just make it quick. Sure thing. Two specials coming right up. As I was saying, if you look at the big picture, don't you think that there's something off about this whole place? Where is it? Or if he really was able to hear us from the distance. I do have some theories, and if I'm right, we might be in trouble. What kind of trouble? What are you talking about? Balance distance on probably better to wait a few minutes anyway. When the waitress brought out meals to the two dragons across the cafe and exchanged a few words with them, Ray's only poured and whispered something. Taste. One that I certainly hadn't acquired yet. I decided to get outside before it was too late. Are you done? Sure am. How do you like it? I'll just say it's probably not for me. You wouldn't be the only one to say that. You better wait outside just in case you decide to come back up again. You tried the odd looking. I stepped outside, taking in the scenery of this strangely familiar world. In the short time I was here, I had already found the similarities between their world and our own utterly fascinating. After all, we were talking about an unmapped place with a never-before-seen form of life. As far as discoveries were concerned, even something as simple as a new unicellular organism or even bacteria would have been remarkable. Yet here I was, standing in the middle of a village evidently built by this race of intelligent talking dragons, with a society not unlike our own. Reza didn't seem to share the same interest, and instead was more smitten with the generator. But given our reason for coming here in the first place, I couldn't blame him for his enthusiasm being focused on something else. My thoughts were interrupted as something quickly zipped past me just a little too close, causing me to stumble back. It was a rather small dragon with a bag clamped to its maw, who apparently had somewhere to be. Yay, dragons! I regained my footing and watched as it disappeared into the distance. Even though I'd seen enough dragons to recognize their variations in size, color, and other attributes, I guess this one must have been a juvenile of its species. Shortly afterwards, Sebastian joined me outside, having taken care of the tab. I gave her a generous tip on your behalf. I hope you don't mind much. How nice of you. In any case, now that you've given us the PDA and Reza has the generator, you're free today. So, if you want to go anywhere in particular, let me know, or I could show you around town. I was tempted to be given a tour, but considering Ray's words, I wanted to be careful not to stray too far without knowing more about this world first. I think I'll stay home for today. I still have to get used to everything, you know? I'll just accompany you back. Yeah. should check out some of the stuff that was written about me, but I thought it was better to keep a low profile for now. I found the kitchen fully stocked with plenty of groceries, but the variety was wasted. Some pictures of what people think humans look like. On some of them, they have like four heads and look nothing like you. It's crazy. Where are you, Worm? Where are you, Worm? A reporter? No, I'm just... Do you want me to remove him? Thank you. produced a small sheet of paper and scribbled a number on it. Afterwards, she just lifted it with both hands. Alright, get what you wanted. Off you go now. Lemons! Of course! Why didn't I realize it sooner? Lemon juice is about the simplest way to write a hidden message using household items. Learn about that in chemistry. In the most boring detail, of course, a message written in lemon juice on paper becomes just about invisible to the naked eye when dried. But after heating it gently, oxidization occurs, making the message visible. I was sitting next to him in class when we learned that. He made a joke about using the method to cheat on the next test, and I replied by saying he'd have to bring an iron. Does he really expect me to remember a random chemistry class that happened years ago? But then, I did remember it after. Meet me at the portal tonight, 10 p.m., was all the message said. I wasted a good amount of time, but I still had time left before I would have to go out and meet Reza, so I decided to make some lunch. Afterwards, I resumed reading my book about the continuing adventures of Sheridan and her exploits in destroying cultural artifacts. Unsurprisingly, it came to a happy end, but the evil organization stopped in its tracks, at least for now. I thought the ending was deliberately left open for ambiguity, but when I turned the page and saw the advent for the next entry in this apparently long series, this long-running series of books, Luckily, the disappointment didn't last long as I had to get going to meet Reza at the portal. When I got outside, it didn't seem quite as dark as when I arrived yesterday. I might have had difficulties finding my way otherwise, but I could still see the portal in the distance. As I was walking, I wondered if anyone was following me, but the land seemed oddly deserted. Is everyone already asleep? It's late, and I should probably be asleep, so I'll end it after this. Eventually, I arrived at my destination. Reza was already standing idly by the portal, just fidgeting, making it obvious that he had waited just for me. I was already wondering whether you'd get it at all. What a wonderful night it is. Just look up at the stars. You can see them so clearly here, without all of the pollution lingering in the air like back home. Almost as if you were looking right into the face of eternity itself. So long, humanity thought we'd find aliens out there, yet after all these years, we found we were still alone in the... Yet after all these years, we found we were still alone in the universe. Turns out we were just not looking in the right place. That sounds like a reference from Pacific Rim. You know, we kept looking into stars for aliens, but it turns out we were looking in the wrong direction, and... Yeah. Pacific Ocean portal. What's going on, Reza? Why did you call me here at this time? For one, because we're sending the generator home. Right. Before I was sent here, they told me they would limit the use of the portal, as they couldn't afford to keep it open all the time. In order to keep in contact with us and to enable us to send things over to them, the portal would be open for just a quarter of an hour each day. Sending something back wasn't really problematic for us, since the high energy expenditure associated with sending bigger objects only affected the sender, not the receiver. However, this also meant that until all business was completed in regards to our trade with the PDAs and generators, we were basically stuck here. As for the other, you know what this place is? It said something about trouble. How much danger are we in, really? More than enough. I'm afraid this whole place will be gone soon. We better not be here when it happens. What? What? You just drop a bomb on me like that? I hoped you'd see it too, but then it took me a while to understand, and I had a head start on you. In any case, while he was speaking, my gaze wandered and fixed on some movement nearby. It was hard to make out anything, but I imagined it might have been wind blowing through the nearby shrubbery, except for the fact that there was no wind. Reza, this might take a while to explain, but we've got the whole night. Reza, look. Look! Look! He turned around to face whatever I was seeing. He squinted hard before he called out. You? How dare you follow me? I think that they messed up. You? How dare you follow me here? Oh, wait. You? How dare you follow me even here? Disturbance. That just doesn't sound like the way he's talked so far. The disturbance came closer, until it became clear it was Maverick, who had hidden nearby to listen in on our conversation. I knew you were up to no good. What were you talking about? What are you planning here? Some kind of attack? I solemnly swear I'm up to no good. Harry Potter reference. Right there, but wait a minute. I have no reason for it. Don't try to deny it. I heard you both talking about it in the cafe. I saw the letter. You think I couldn't smell the lemon on it? Pathetic. You'll have to come with me to the police station now. Both of you. Come on, I think you're overreacting. What? No! Razor, what are you doing? I'm saving that. Razor, what are you doing? Come on, Bolt, let's get out of here! In the dragon's side, I could see the wound where the bullet had penetrated his hide. A trickle of blood stained his dark scales and the earth. Earth beneath. Razor used the opportunity to run off in some direction. I wasn't sure which. I frankly scanned my surroundings looking for Razor, though he had already vanished into darkness. What was I supposed to do? Run away as well? Help Maverick? I was just a diplomat and I had no idea what was happening. Suddenly, the dragon whipped around, hitting me in the guts with his thick tail. I was lifted off the ground briefly before I felt the impact of my body hitting the ground hard enough that my vision blurred almost immediately. A deafening roar battered my ears. Was this his cry for help? I could barely move, but I found it better not to try, as to not startle the wounded dragon more than he already was. It certainly would have ended badly for me if he tried anything. I heard him take a few unsure steps before he lay down, prone on the ground, panting. I'm still watching you, you know. And you better not move, for your own good. If I have to get up again and come after you in this condition, I can't promise you I won't be nice. It took a few minutes of listening to his labored breathing before someone arrived. It was two dragons. The first I recognized as Sebastian. The other, I didn't know. I heard Sebastian and Maverick exchange a few words. When the stocky fellow approached me. Hey, kid, you alright? I'm Bryce, the chief of police in this town. Can you tell me what happened? Maverick followed us here and tried to apprehend us. Is that so? His face was stern and seemingly lost in thoughts as I overheard Sebastian's conversation. Yeah, but you're the flyer on duty. We probably won't find him now. Not here in the darkness, at any rate. Well, that's just brilliant. What do you think, Chief? Bolt, can you walk? Yeah, I think so. All right, Sebastian, take Bolt to the apartment. Get us some help here for Maverick, and then we'll look for Reza. Right on! Come on, Bolt, I'll help you up. I was still shaken up by the events I just witnessed when I arrived at my apartment. Not knowing anything better to do, I soon fell into a sleep slumber. Soon fell into a deep slumber.
Thank you.
Oh, that's nice. I click to quit and it just crashes out on me. I guess that's a glitch for having such a new game. Anyways, bye-bye!